July 4th, kind of our holiday evening when we come together here. I don't remember the time. I think we just said we were going to do like 5 to 7:30 this year. But we're going to do hot dogs and hamburgers. And if you want to volunteer to help cook hot dogs and hamburgers on the grill, that would be appreciated. But we're going to do that and have card games. You know, those of you that like to come, bring board games for the tables, dominoes, whatever. Bring those things for Sunday evening. And then we'll have the meal. We'll eat about 6 o'clock, something like that. And we're going to have like a water slide, a blow-up water slide for the kids to play on outside. And so just have a lot of things going on and just chance. You know, we don't get a lot of time, even though our church cooks and eats a whole lot. A lot of times we don't get a lot of time just to sit down and just informally enjoy each other and get to know each other a little better. And so we're going to do that on this Sunday evening. And just, the Bible calls that koinonia, our fellowship. And it's just that shared experience of really kind of getting to know each other in an informal setting. So if you would just try to plan to be here, be a part of that this week. The following Sunday, now this Sunday is July the 2nd. The following Sunday, the 9th, we have a gentleman going to be with us who's going to speak on Sunday morning. And then on Sunday night from 5 to 7, he's going to do a witness training program. It's about learning. The whole day will be focused on how to learn to be a better witness, how to learn to share your faith. And so it's going to be a real emphasis that day. And so I know you'll look forward to being here and being a part of that. Then the following Sunday, the 16th, we'll start that. We'll regular Sunday morning, but Sunday night we're going to start that series on how to have a biblical worldview. It's just a lot of, we'll have like a 15-minute video, and then we'll discuss it. It'll be all the men and women together in here for 6 weeks on Sunday night. So I hope you'll enjoy being a part of that. Okay? Any questions about upcoming things? Those of you on the Leadership Council, that'll meet next. In fact, it's our quarterly meeting, so all of the Leadership Council and in kind of committee chairs, we'll all meet together next Wednesday night at 4:15. Okay. What I want to talk to you about tonight, I'm going to get up where y'all are, okay? I'm going to be where y'all are. Tonight, I want to talk to you about something I was going to talk to you about a couple of weeks ago, and we wound up, y'all wanted to do the question and answer thing. I'm going to talk to you about inductive Bible study tonight, just kind of how to study your Bible and how to get the most out of it. And I want to use a text of Scripture, Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, as kind of a text for us to work with tonight. And it's the story about the four people that brought their friend, brought someone to Jesus. Jesus is there at a house, and they get there, and there's so many people there, they can't even get in the house, and they... What do? How do they go about getting him in the house? Anybody remember? Had to open the roof, didn't they? Had to tear open the roof. I bet I could have heard the building grounds committee when that roof started tearing off. They said, good Lord, who's going to pay for that? But, and what I'd like to show you tonight and go through with you, because it's something that's real practical, but... You know, you'd be surprised over the years how many people have asked me, how do you study your Bible? How do you really get the most out of it? And there'll be a lot of folks thinking that in our church that's not here tonight, you know, that could learn that. And never miss an opportunity to be here, because you might miss something you really wish you'd have been here for. And so tonight, that's what we're going to talk about. And in these 12 verses, I want to pull out 12 things that I believe... are pertinent things that you ought to, and what you do, it means that you read a verse and you ask a question about that verse. What's unique in that verse? What should I get out of that? God, what was unique about what happened right there in that story, in that verse? Sometimes it may not be one verse, it may be two or three verses together before you pick up one event. But I've pulled out 12 things out of these verses. I want to see how many you can pull out tonight. I want you to study through it with me, and let's see what stands out. You know, you could read over these verses and say, well, I see a couple things there. Or you could read over these verses and say, I see a dozen or so things there. There's a lot of things there that God's trying to show us. And if you could get a dozen nuggets of gold out of something, or you can get two, I'd rather have a dozen than two. Amen? So that's what I want to show you how tonight, is kind of how to take a text of Scripture, a story, and pull some things out of that that would really mean a lot to you personally, that would speak to you personally. All right? I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer before we start and ask God to bless us in this. Father, as we read Scriptures tonight, we are reminded, Lord, that You are the author of those Scriptures. The Holy Spirit is the teacher of those Scriptures and the one who helps us to apply them to our lives. I pray You give us eyes and a heart to see things tonight, to maybe learn how to study the Bible different than we have in the past. And God, I pray that You would help us to get everything You have for us out of the Scriptures. And You'd help us to study to show ourselves approved workmen who need not be ashamed, because we rightly divide the word of truth. Thank You for what You're going to do, Lord. Teach us tonight. It's never too old. We're never too old to learn. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Tonight, as we look at these, again, if you look at the first verse, let's read that first verse. Put it up there, Daniel, if you would. And again, he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. He entered Capernaum. I just can't read that without thinking we went there, Steve. You know, we went there. We got to go there. It jumps out at you when you've been somewhere. That's where Peter's home was at, on the coast of Galilee. But what jumps out at you in that text? Anything jump out at you about that? Talk about. Huh? Well, he had been in that area around the Sea of Galilee. I don't know. It doesn't tell us. I don't remember, be honest with you, whether he'd been in Capernaum before. But you could go back and talk a little bit what Capernaum was like. There was a big synagogue there. There were some big millstones there. And it's possible that's where he saw the millstone. And he said, if you put this, you know, you hurt one of these kids, you better put this around your neck and go jump in the ocean. But anyway, what jumps out? Anybody else?
The people that heard it,
here's what jumped out at me. It was heard that he was in the house. How was it heard? That's right. It was heard. How does it get heard? How is the news? You know what needs to go out throughout this community? Man, that Jesus is involved down there. That Jesus is real. He's genuine. He's not just some idol down there. He's real, touching people's lives. And even that in your home, it could be heard about your home. Your neighbors may say, well, I'll tell you this, I don't know everything about my neighbors, but I'm going to tell you, I hear Jesus is real to those folks. He's there. They talk to him like he lives right there. And that's what jumps out at me about this first verse. How did they hear, though? People talked about it. If we don't talk about the Lord, people aren't going to know about the Lord. If we don't get excited about the Lord, people aren't going to know about what God's doing. So the first, your number one right there, is that bottom part. It'll always be right on the bottom. I'm putting the verse on the top, and then the first thing that you look, when you look at this text inductively, meaning you're trying to dig out of it, from every phrase, we're going to try to get a meaning out of that. It was heard. How did that happen? It was talked about. Okay? So that's number one. Let's read the second verse. Daniel, if you'll put that next one up there. Immediately, many gathered together so that there was no room to receive them even near the door. In other words, in Okaloosa translation, was it was so packed you couldn't get another soul in that house. It was packed. Wouldn't it be neat if that was heard about our churches? We heard that Jesus was at our church, and there's so many people down there you can barely get another person in the church. Fire marshals are concerned about what's going on down there. I'm going to tell you, if the word gets out that Jesus is here doing what he wants to do, guess what? The house will fill up. It'll fill up. It won't fill up for religion. It won't fill up for more knowledge. But it'll fill up if word gets out that Jesus is here. And he's real. And he's doing something. Yet in this world we live in today, there'd still probably be a lot of people saying, well, I don't care. I don't care. But most people are looking for a real Jesus who people are genuine about the Lord. Put the bottom of that one up there. Here's what comes out to me about that. People wanted to show up where Jesus was. They wanted to be there. And so we must ask ourselves this question. Obviously, there was a stir going on in this house, in this community, about Jesus being there. But don't we need to, for there to be a stir in our community and in our churches that makes people want to show up? Hello? You know why most people don't go to church today? They say one of the big issues, if you poll people on why they don't go, they say they don't see the relevance of religion, as the way they'll put it, or of God anymore. But I'm here to tell you, if they knew Jesus was here and he's doing things, he's touching lives, people will show up for what's real. They won't show up for what's artificial, but they'll show up for what's real. Okay? And what's vibrant and what makes a difference in our lives. All right, let's look at the third verse. And Jesus, it's actually the last part of verse 2, but the third part. But Jesus preached the word to them. He preached the word to them. I think you get the same thing out of that that I get out of that, don't you? That we can gather together. You see what I'm doing? I'm just taking a phrase here and the next phrase and the next phrase. And what stands out about that? He preached the word to them. He didn't play bingo. He didn't do a crossword puzzle. They didn't play tag or chase. They didn't watch the football game on TV. Jesus said, these folks need a word from God. Are you with me? I'll be honest with you, the only real reason to leave the house, even though fellowship is good, the main thing people need when they leave their house is they need to know Jesus showed up and he had a word for them. Where two or three are gathered together, he's here in the midst. But people, the only reason people ought to be willing to leave their regular business of their life is they feel like God's got a word for them. And some people don't want that word, I'll admit. Some people don't want to hear God's words. Daniel, if you'll do the bottom part. He preached the word to them. Not some philosophy, psychology. He didn't teach them something about how to help themselves be a better person. He preached the word to them. What's the Bible say about preaching? How important is preaching the word, as it says Jesus did to them? How important is that? Huh? Very important? Well, tell me why it's important. Tell me why that's important. I mean, when that jumps out at me, when it says Jesus preached the word to them, this third thing. Right. They weren't just there to eat a meal. They weren't just there to have a party. Jesus had a message from God for them. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians that it's by the foolishness of preaching that men and women are saved. Well, what, foolishness of preaching? Or what's that mean? What's that mean? Does that mean that when I get up there and preach on Sunday morning, I'm playing the fool? Huh? What do you think that means? Talk to me. Yeah, but why is that foolishness? What Paul said. Right. To the lost person, they don't think, well, why is he doing that? What's that word? Why is he preaching? What's that about? How's that going to help anybody? He needs to give me money. He needs to give me something to eat. How's preaching going to help me? But it's by that, what he's saying, the world sees it as foolishness. The world may call it foolishness, but God says it's salvation. It's transforming. You see, the Holy Spirit's job is to take that word. How are we saved? It says over in 1 Peter chapter 1 that we're saved by the incorruptible word of God. Seed, it says, of the word of God. The Bible, when you preach it or you teach it in a Sunday school class, it's just like planting a seed. It's like planting a seed that then God's going to give the increase. And you're saying, God, what he's saying here is, you're telling me by just preaching these words, it's going to change people's life? Man, don't you have to do something? Give them money, feed them, give them an education, whatever. That's how it's going to fix their life? No. First thing they got to get right is salvation. And that's what he's saying. So it jumps out at me there that this issue of preaching the word, man, Jesus got this group together. They're having a get together there, and all of a sudden he comes in and he's got a word for them. And it saves the soul, and then it grows the person. It sanctifies a person. All right, the next one, Daniel. In verse 3, it says, they came to him bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. A person who's paralyzed comes to him now and is brought to him now by four men. Does anything jump out at you about that in verse 3?
They had faith.
I'm sorry?
They had faith.
They brought him, didn't they? They could have taken him to the doctor. They could have took him down to the pool of Siloam and when the waters moved, push him off in the water. They could have took him to Benny Hinn's church and let him do his thing to him, but they probably had some healers back in their day. Right. So there is something we get out of these four people bringing this paralyzed person to Jesus, right? What else? Who else had something over here? Right, right. Yeah, put the bottom up, Daniel. A group of four friends. Here's what jumps out at me. Yes, it does mean that they had faith. They brought him. You know, it doesn't even say that they were friends of his. I've always kind of read it. Four of his friends brought him. And they may have been, but Scripture doesn't say that. Scripture doesn't say they were his old buddies that he went to high school with. It may have just been four people who cared about others, who got their eyes off of themselves for a little while and thought about somebody else. Sometimes we can't get our eyes off of ourselves to care enough about somebody else. So this group of four bring this needy person. They took off their own time, their own energy, and did what they could to get this guy there. So that's the first thing that jumps out to me about these guys. And here's a man who could do nothing to heal himself. What about this? Isn't that a picture of salvation? Because there's nothing we can do to save ourselves. Not a thing we can do. This man was dependent. just like we must have the Spirit of God draw us to salvation, here's a man that was dependent. Just like a person who's lost is dependent upon God totally for salvation. All right, put the next one up, Daniel. You see what I'm saying? Do you see what we're doing here? We're taking it kind of verse by verse and even phrase by phrase and saying, what jumps out about that? What do I see about that? Because you know what we do? We have a tendency just to read over a story real quick and say, okay, there's 12 verses about these people who brought this guy to Jesus and he got healed. Okay, that's a story about healing. Let's move on. This story is about so much more than just this guy getting healed. In fact, that's by the end of it, you see, it's almost a side story. That's just one of 12 things that jump out in this story. And so inductive means we're piecing it, we're bringing it out piece by piece. It's a way you do kind of exegetical preaching. It's another word for it. But inductive means that you ask a lot of questions of the text. Verse 4, and when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was healing. I love that picture there. They pulled down the roof. They basically did whatever it took to get him there. Huh? They were determined, weren't they? They weren't discouraged easily. It's a picture of faith, yes. But, huh? Focus. What about people who are willing to do whatever it takes to get somebody to Jesus? Whatever it takes. We almost don't know what that means. Hello? Are you with me? We almost don't know what that means. To do whatever it takes to get somebody to Jesus. The bottom, Daniel. But I thought about this. There's a house that's packed out with people. There's a person coming to the door. That need may be salvation. That need may be healing. Whatever that need may be. But we need to be careful that we don't get in the way of what God wants to do. How hard would it have been for some of those folks to part and say, hey, there's somebody back here with a need greater than all of us. Let them through. How easy would it have been for 10 or 15 of those folks to walk outside till they got that guy to Jesus? But instead, nobody's moving. Ain't getting my spot. I got here early. Ain't getting my spot. I got up here close to the stage. And yet, they're willing. These guys are willing to say, you may get in God's way, I'll find another way. I think there's this point for there on us, though. Have you ever thought about the fact, some of the great revivals of history says, it usually began because a few people said, God, whatever I need to do, God, show me that. God, if I need to confess some sin, if I need to get right with somebody, if I need to forgive somebody, God, whatever needs to happen, God, do it. You ever wonder if we get in the way of revival sometimes? Is that possible? We're in a hurry. Or maybe we got some sin we want to hang on to and we don't want to let that sin go. You know, we could very well stop revival sometimes. Instead of wanting God to do what God wants to do, we're thinking, man, I'm starving to death. I'm ready to go eat. Or we're thinking, ball game's fixing to start. I want to go to the ball game. Or we're thinking this or that, whatever it may be. But it's not about God getting the glory. They were on the verge of a mighty miracle of God. And thank God these four men didn't give up and quit. They were willing. Mary was at my last church one Sunday, and a lady came in late, and one of my ushers, who was not what I would call a spiritual giant, lady came to the door, and she was looking inside, and we were pretty full that morning, and she was trying to find a place to sit, and she asked, she said, "Is this such and such person here?" And he said, "No." He said, "I haven't seen them. They're not here." He said, "Maybe you want to come back next Sunday and see if they're here." Now, there's somebody that's just about getting in the way of what God wants to do. Maybe God wanted to save that person. Maybe God wanted to call them to preach. Whatever it may have been, he's thinking, "Well, maybe you just ought to come back next Sunday. We're kind of full today." Yeah. But this is a first-time visitor. He didn't know whether they fit or not. But you're right. Oh, yeah. Not dressed right. Not the right color. Yeah. By the way, can anybody come to this church no matter what color you are? Are we just for people that look just like us? Huh? If they're coming for the right reason. Not to cause trouble, not because they want to stone the preacher, right? If we look at how Jesus loved everybody, I'd be real disappointed if I would serve in a church where people said, "Well, if you're not the same color as us, you can't come." I'd be afraid in a church like that that God was going to write "Ichabod, the glory has departed," over the front door of the church.
How do we know what color Jesus is to begin with?
Well, I know. He was white, yellow, brownish. He probably wasn't lily white. That's right. Okay. Daniel, the next one. When Jesus saw their faith, in verse 5, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." What does that say to us? Daniel, put the bottom on there. Jesus had seen their faith. I think that phrase right there stands out. He saw their faith. Does he see our faith? Does Jesus see your faith? You see, faith is an active word unless it's used as a noun. Particularly the word faith is a verb. It's an action word. That's right. That's why the Bible says don't just be hearers of the word, be doers. These committed friends would not be stopped from their efforts to help this man. He saw their faith. Anything else stand out at you about that verse?
I got a question.
Okay.
It says right there, it says, "Jesus said, Son, your sins are forgiven." He didn't have to die to forgive those sins.
Right.
Your sins are forgiven. He can forgive sin without having to die. But I know that the blood had to be shed.
Well, it's just like the Old Testament saints. People got saved by faith in the Old Testament. Abraham's believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. But go ahead.
By his faith.
Yeah, by his faith.
But eventually, blood had to be shed.
Eventually, yeah, it did. But you have to understand, at this point, they're still in the Old Testament covenant. We don't have a New Testament yet.
But our sin could be forgiven because of our faith without Jesus' death. Eventually, blood had to be shed.
Yeah. Well, people have been saved the same way forever. Except the Old Testament, they were placing their faith in the Lamb of God that would come one day. And in the New Testament, we're looking back at the cross, thanking God for the fact that Jesus has come and shed his blood for our sins. Both required faith. One, he hadn't come yet. One, faith in what he did for us on the cross. But yet still faith.
Okay, you just said that we're looking.
to the. They are, but they haven't seen the cross yet. That's the key. And you have to understand at this point in his life, there's still people questioning who he is. They wasn't sure he was the Messiah. Some of them weren't. I think it'll tie together because this is discussed in the next couple of verses. When they begin, the Pharisees now begin to say, well, who are you to forgive sins? And was forgiving his sins the right thing to say? Should he maybe have just said, you're healed, rise up and walk? Right. So, but the key is the first part of this verse. Faith is involved in it. He saw their faith. How many times have we seen people prayed for? You remember the centurion whose daughter needed to be healed? And Jesus said, your faith has made her whole. And he worked off of the dad's faith in the healing process. I think we're going to clarify this. Let's talk about it some more here in the next verse or two. Look what it says. So I'm sorry. You're right. Exactly. Yeah, I meant to clarify that and did not. Thank you for clarifying that because, yeah, he's not just talking about the four. He's talking about the group. This is a group's faith. They had to say, this man had to say, yeah, take me. I believe he could do something. Otherwise, he could have said, man, y'all ain't taking me over there. I ain't Baptist. I ain't going to see Jesus. It's a Baptist. He just goes to the Baptist houses, you know. I'm Pentecostal. I ain't going over there. Or whatever.
Like we are today, the preacher's the worst one. But, you know, we'll pray for everybody else, but don't bother praying for me.
Yeah.
You know, I'm okay with don't pray for me.
Yeah.
And I say preacher's the worst one, but I know too many of them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, dare mention your problem.
Yeah.
It's
not that they don't have faith. I think it's just the fact that sometimes I think we preachers just like, I'm here to minister to you. I'm not here to put my needs out in front of you all the time. You know what I'm saying? Shouldn't be that way, but that's what happens. It is. It is. Look at the last part of that verse when he said, son, your sins are forgiven you. Put the bottom up, Daniel. Son, your sins are forgiven you. Was sin his problem? And here's what jumps out at me. This is part of the inductive Bible study. What does that mean? Your sins are forgiven you. Well, he didn't come to have his sins forgiven. He came to be healed. He came because he was sick and paralyzed, not because he was lost. You know what jumps out at me? Is Jesus saw that his need was more than physical. His need was spiritual. Both spiritual and physical. And Jesus met both needs. Was sin his problem? Or should that even matter to us? So when you do an inductive Bible study, you pull out things like this. You say, sins are forgiven you. Now, wait a minute. He didn't come to get his sins forgiven. Why is it talking about his sins? And was that the right thing to say? Well, the next verse talks about that. Put the next one up, Daniel. Some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God? What jumps out at you about that? Anything of significance? Do we get anything? Anything we need to dig a little deeper on in these two verses? Okay, not everybody's there for the right reasons. What else? What else jumps out of that, guys?
They didn't believe he was the Messiah.
They definitely didn't believe he was the one who had the right to forgive sins. Only God can do that. A lot of them were thinking about their own agenda, or maybe even their own theology, and they were not open to the fact that maybe the Messiah they'd been looking for centuries was right there in front of them. They wouldn't entertain that thought. What else? Well, they sure didn't think he was the Messiah, did they? The bottom, Daniel? Instead of focusing on the blessing, now here's your typical stiff shirt, maybe, you know, unrighteous religious leaders who are sitting there, and instead of focusing on the blessing, they're trying to trap somebody. They're trying to find something negative. They're trying to maybe find a perceived blasphemy. Now, what should their heart have been like? Yeah, here's a guy that's getting up and walking away. Jesus just told him, your sins are forgiven, take up your bed, go home, you know. Here's a guy getting up, walking away, who'd been paralyzed his whole life. And instead of focusing on the good, they're focused on finding fault. Don't think for a minute some folks don't go to church with the attitude to find fault.
That's what I was
going to say. They were very judgmental. Yeah. But they thought they were doing God's work. They were protecting God here. What they were protecting was their theology, their view of God. Hey, folks, never fall. This is what jumps out at me about this. Never fall into the trap of missing the good to highlight the bad. I'll give you an example. Had a group of youth one time, went to an event. I think four or five of them got saved. They got back late on a Friday or Saturday night from that event. Celebrating, four or five of them got saved. On Sunday, somebody went out and checked the van, and there was some trash left on the floor of the van, and they threw a fit. They threw a fit because there was gum wrappers on the floor and Coke bottles and potato chip bags. No celebration about the ones that got saved. No even searching for why that happened. But it's just, I knew they was going to mess this van up. That's why I came out and checked it. That's the least important thing. Amen? People got saved. People got saved. It's kind of like, what if somebody walked in this church with a pair of shorts on, a male, let's say, with a pair of shorts? And you and I know, well, it's probably not the best thing to wear to church, but it's kind of a traditional thing. And that person walks down the aisle and gets saved during an invitation. Let me tell you something. I don't care what kind of shorts he had on. I'm thankful he got saved. I ain't going to sit back there and say, well, doggone it, I don't know about that. They come down through here with shorts on and got saved. That's embarrassing. Wouldn't that be ridiculous if we did that? We need to look at things the way God looks at things. Okay, next one, Daniel. Verse 8. Let's dig into verse 8. But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? What jumps out at you about that? What do you think Jesus, how do you think Jesus perceived that? Yeah. Waylon said, who are you to question me? But you know what I noticed? It didn't say they stood up and confronted him about it. He perceived about what they were thinking in their heart. There's a word there for us. Hey, folks, you might fool the preacher, your Sunday school teacher, your mom and dad, but you're not going to fool God. He knows what's in your heart. And he saw them out there probably whispering to each other. or he saw the frustration on their face. I can't believe that guy walked down the aisle with shorts on. Isn't it amazing how we can lose focus of what's most important? That's what these guys had done. They had lost the focus of what was most important, and they were agonizing over stuff that really wasn't important. Wow. Bottom, Daniel. Just notice how Lee Jesus looked into the heart. And you can't fool the Lord. Anything else that jumps out at you about that verse? Next verse, verse 9. And so they've challenged Jesus now on who is he to say your sins are forgiven. And so he says here in verse 9, which is easier to say to the paralytic? Your sins are forgiven you, or say, arise, take up your bed and walk. Jesus basically saying, I could have said anything. It wasn't really what I said. It was the power that I put out. What does that say to you? What do you get anything out of that? Was Jesus wrong to say your sins are forgiven you? I mean, he didn't pray exactly the sinner's prayer. But what Jesus saw in him was the same thing he saw in these scribes. He saw his heart. And what he saw in his heart was repentance. He saw in his heart someone who believed that he was his creator, and the one who created him could fix him. He saw something in his heart. I don't know what he saw. Guess what? I don't have to know what he saw. It really don't matter, does it? Jesus saw something in this man's heart that was repentant. And he responded to that repentance in a way that says, I see your faith. Your sins are forgiven, buddy. Rise up and walk. I mean, the word then is, you can imagine that strength is coming back in his legs. So it didn't really matter what he said, did it? Daniel, the bottom part. Jesus could have said, get up, son. I fixed you both physically and spiritually. The words don't matter like the outcome. Focus on the outcome. You know, they're sitting there wanting to chew him out because he didn't say the right words. Thinking about the guy getting up walking. Thinking about the guy just got his sins forgiven. They upset because Jesus didn't use the right words. Yeah, that's what they should have said, shouldn't they? They should have said, guys, that's what we always knew the Messiah would be able to do. Could this be him? They never searched in their hearts for true faith, true belief. They didn't have any faith. They had religion, and they knew their religion, and they knew he didn't fit into their religion. That's what they knew.
But the one that had the biggest impact is eternal. And nobody else, they could have walked away and reasoned, yeah, we saw it, you know, they got a little voodoo doctor over here that fixed that, and somebody else, but what he did, nobody could claim.
Right.
And we forget to give God credit for the knowledge and the experience that people in the medical field have taken.
Can I give you one more thing that jumps out at me? Now, this is just a preacher in me just digging, saying, okay, is there another little nugget there we don't see? When this man was brought to him paralyzed, think with me, what do I get out of that? This man had really two needs. He had a spiritual need and he had a physical need. And what Jesus addressed was the fact of what this man needed the most. He needed his sins forgiven worse than he needed his bones and muscles healed. Because one dealt with eternity And I think Jesus said what he said as a witness to those scribes right there in that room. That this man's greatest need was salvation. Not rise up your bed, walk. His greatest need is your sins have been forgiven. Yeah.
And would have walked away, or would have went away, if he cared about that bed, pure joy.
Mm-hmm. Because his sins had been forgiven. And he saw the fact that this man was willing to come to him in his condition.
Accepted him.
Yeah. Knew that that was his only hope. I don't understand everything about salvation. I know we have to see our sin and we have to be repentant of that sin. But let me tell you something. I might need to hear it so that I can't read your heart. So I might ask you to pray in repentance and ask God to forgive your sins and believe that Jesus rose from the dead and, you know, all that stuff that the Bible mentions, because I can't read your heart. But I'm here to tell you, salvation is a result of a decision you make in your heart between you and God. A person laying on their deathbed, maybe live the most sinful life, the last minute before they die, in their heart, they could say, "Oh God, I'm so sorry." And God could save them. They may not even be able to talk, but God could save them if he sees in their heart repentance. So let's don't limit God to what we can see and we can understand. Okay? Next one, Daniel.
Still a question. I know that repentance is very important. But to me, I'm sorry for a lot of time. But accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior is totally different.
Well, repentance is not a... It's really the result, I guess you could say, after repentance. But repentance is just simply a change of direction. God, I've been going the wrong direction, and I'm turning to you as Savior and Lord. So it's kind of a process of turning. Some would say they almost happen at the same time, the repentance and the profession.
That's more than just saying I'm sorry.
It is. Yeah, you can be sorrow and not be repentant. Be sorry and not be repentant. Yeah, God has to see that. Here's what repentance means. God, you see, if I'm sorry and I get well and walk out of this hospital, I'm going to keep doing what I've always been doing. But if I'm repentant and I walk out of this hospital, I'm going to be a different man. That's the difference.
As in the definition of repentant in the world, I don't understand. They just see it.
Right. And that's our job to teach that. And that's why there's a lot. And the Bible says, unless a man repent, we shall all likewise perish. That's the first message Jesus and John the Baptist preached, was repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repentance is important. And I struggle a little bit with somebody who just says, "Oh, you want to go to heaven? Just tell God you want to be saved." Hey, if there's no acknowledgement of our sinfulness and no repentance, can we really be saved? I guess God knows. Again, that's one of them God things. God looks at a person's heart. But I struggle with sometimes not making that clear to that person, that repentance is a new direction, just like lordship is a new direction. Verses 10 and 11. Let me finish up quickly here. "But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." Jesus was using this as a teaching moment to these scribes sitting out there. He said, "I want you guys to see who's before you. I can forgive sins." He looked over at that paralytic who he'd forgiven the sins. He said, "Now take up your bed and go home, boy. Go home. Walk out the front door." And Jesus made a statement there. Does that say anything to you? Is there a nugget you can get out of that? Anybody? Daniel, if you'll put that up. When you meet Jesus, he says, I want to make sure you understand, you're meeting the Holy One of Heaven. But not only are you meeting the Holy One of Heaven, you're meeting the Healer of Heaven, the Great Physician. And he can handle all of your problems. See, by doing these two things, Jesus is saying, man, I can take care of your spiritual need and I can take care of your physical needs. In other words, Jesus says there's no limits to how I can help you in so many ways. You see that? Anybody see anything else? Last verse, Daniel. Verse 12. Immediately he arose, took up his bed, went out of the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. And we could just fly over that verse and say, well, that's a good ending. Does anything jump out in that verse? Yeah. Man, they sent out another witness, didn't they? Amen. He conquered his bed, didn't he? Yep. Became his victory. One of the things that stood out to me is I looked at it and looked for a nugget in it. It was those three little words. All were amazed. As a preacher, what does that say, God? How can I use that? How should we use that? What does that say to us? Daniel? If they were feeling that way? Said all. I don't know if it was the Pharisees, the scribes. I don't know if it was them. Yeah. But look at what I say here. This is what jumped out at me about this verse. How long has it been since you were amazed at Jesus? How long has it been since you were amazed at church? How long has it been since you saw God move and you said, wow? Chuck Kelly says that famous Hebrew word, wow. If it's been a while, why don't you take a fresh, close look? You ever take things for granted? Huh? You probably don't appreciate Miss Karen as much as you used to. Come on, Dale. Let me make an illustration out of this, you know? When you've been married a long time, don't we begin to take each other for granted? We just assume that they're always going to be there and just like you come in and turn the light switch on, you just assume the lights are going to come on, right? Until the day you come in, you turn the switch on and nothing happens. We can lose the amazement of the blessings of God all around us. And we can become calloused to the goodness of God's grace. And sometimes we just have to pause and remind ourselves, God is so good. Look at our wives and say, thank you for being there for me. And forgive me for taking you for granted. I do that. I think most of us do. You, Miss Dawn. You, Miss Dawn, I do. I take her for granted. She's always takes care of my lightweight. It's really the heavyweight. Father, as we close tonight, we ask you, Lord, to just remind us, Lord, that all around us there's that ability to be amazed. Just the fact that we've got a nice home to live in with air conditioning. If it's the fact that we've got food to eat, when so many people in this world have no food to eat, Is it the fact that, God, you keep us alive? You've given us family. God, you've loved on us. You've saved us. We've seen people healed. And yet, God, we almost expect it. Like we deserve it. God, remind us to be amazed at your glory. And it's in Jesus' name.